Good morning. We'll start with damning allegations against the Hawthorn Football Club, and this just in at the moment. AFL boss Gillon McLachlan is speaking live in Melbourne. We're going to take you there live right now.
We will do everything to ensure that the hurt you experienced is not a hurt that is experienced by others.
So Gillon, Alistair Clarkson and Chris Fagan, they won't be stood down pending the outcome of the investigation. You'll wait for that?
I've obviously had conversations this morning with clubs, representatives of those accused, and I feel that the way that they will be approaching this impending investigation will be clear today. And I'll leave it to the clubs and the representatives to make their positions clear on how they're going to approach this.
It's a club's responsibility to make that clear.
We are working with those clubs, and I feel that there'll be a clarity on that in the coming hours.
You mentioned how badly this reads and presents, and obviously the foremost are the people involved. But did those representatives offer any type of plausible explanation to you this morning as to how we could get to the situation involving these allegations?
I haven't had those conversations, Tom, in terms of alternate views. That would be the role of an independent panel that will give natural justice to those accused and get to the bottom of these very serious allegations.
When have you spoken to Alistair Clarkson?
Sorry? Not today.
What does natural justice mean?
It means the appropriate forum for those who are accused to tell their stories and give their version of the events. I've committed to Paul Marsh and to Alistair Nixon, the Coach Association, that they will have a say in the formation. And these were people who are appropriately qualified in a functional sense, with an appropriately diverse background and appropriate skills to do that. And I think when you see the credibility of the individuals and their qualifications, I feel comfortable that people regard as the right people to do this.
Gil, how wide is the ambit of the review? I'm not in any way apportioning blame or making assumptions, but it's well documented that a lot of people, successful people in footy, from Hawthorn, branch off into different parts of the industry.
I think the allegations will be fully investigated, and that's the job of the panel, Tom, and those therefore caught up in it will be picked up in it.
When did you know?
We got it about a week ago. I've read the report. There's more today than is not in the report. And obviously it's a tough read.
When were you planning on releasing it?
It's a confidential report. We don't know who the complainants are. It's de-identified. There's a lot of stuff to work through.
So, what do you mean weeks, next week, the week after?
What's the question?
When were you planning on releasing the report?
It's a confidential report, not planning on releasing the report.
Information. Announcing the report, discussing the report.
The information is we don't publicly disclose any investigations until they're complete. There's multiple investigations going at any point in time, and that's part of the process is that people make allegations, normally they're dealt with confidentially, so those accused have the opportunity to respond. That is not happening in this case, and we now think it's appropriate for an independent group to look at those.
Last year, from your perspective, we've now in recent years had situations around Adam Woods, we've had the Adelaide Care, we've had the Collingwood Drew Bedell report, you know, a full situation on the fourth club. There will be natural questions asked about how systemic treatment like this or First Nations people is in the AFL. Have we got a bigger problem than the game got a bigger problem than the rest of the community does?
I think the country has a bigger problem. When the Do Better report was released, I said very plainly then that I think if you looked at any organisation in the country, specifically for issues in relation to the treatment, cultural safety of Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander people, you would anticipate finding a problem. I don't think we're immune to that. It's really clear that we're not. And so we will definitely think in broader scope when the time is right, but we've got a really urgent, pressing issue right here and now, which has to take absolute priority. But of course we're thinking about the broader issues.
We're going to leave that press conference there to give you some context if you're not up to speed with this story. These are allegations surrounding the Hawthorn Football Club and the way they treated its Indigenous players. Well, under the leadership of Alistair Clarkson, who was the then coach, and Chris Fagan, now an external review alleges key figures of the club demanded the separation of young First Nations players from their partners. One player has reportedly been told was told to encourage his partner to terminate her pregnancy in order to benefit his career. Now, we just caught the end of Gillon McLachlan's press conference then, the boss of the AFL. He has announced an independent review again, and it will be set up in the next 24 hours by four key people. His comments this morning: these are serious allegations. We take them very seriously. We need to do more. So many people are hurting today and have been hurting for a long time. So the AFL's response to this morning, that an independent review will be set up within the next 24 hours involving a panel of four people, and we'll keep you up to date if any more developments break. Well, Prime Minister Anthony Albanese and the Governor-General, along with a number of key Australians who attended the Queen's funeral, have touched back down in Sydney this morning following their historic visit to the UK. It comes as fresh details revealed about a service for Australia's National Day of Mourning, which will be marked in a public holiday tomorrow. Lara Vella has more.
Well, this is a special RAAF aircraft that has just touched down here at Sydney Airport. On board, the Prime Minister, Anthony Albanese, alongside his partner, and a delegation of Australian guests that made the journey to the United Kingdom to witness Her Majesty the Queen's funeral. The Prime Minister, though, will no doubt once again be asked questions about whether or not Australia should have a serious conversation about becoming a republic. Earlier in the week, the PM said now is not an appropriate time, and it seems that the majority of Australians agree with the Prime Minister's sentiments, because according to a poll published in nine newspapers, only 46% of Australians at this stage would support the nation becoming a republic. That is a drop of support of around 54% earlier in the year when another poll was initially conducted. Now, tomorrow, the engagements will once again continue for Prime Minister Anthony Albanese, because tomorrow is a national day of mourning right across the country in honour of Her Majesty. Both the PM alongside the opposition leader will be giving short tributes. There will also be several performances, including from the Australian Girls Choir, and Anthony Kalia will be performing the national anthem. And at 11 a.m, there will be a one-minute silence.
And flags have returned to full mast in the United Kingdom as the 10-day mourning period comes to an end. King Charles has been seen heading to Balmoral in Scotland as members of the royal family step away from public duties for a further 7 days of private grief. Around the UK, a huge clean-up, though, is underway after thousands descended upon London to bear witness to the historic funeral procession. Foreign Minister Penny Wong is likely to meet her Chinese counterpart this week for the second time since Labor won government. A further sign Australia's relationship with Beijing is stabilising. Let's bring our politics reporter in, Eliza Edwards. Eliza, good morning. Is the meeting a done deal, though?
Davina, not yet. Negotiations are still happening for this meeting on the sidelines of the UN General Assembly in New York in coming days. The Foreign Minister is there representing Australia and sitting down with a host of her counterparts. If the discussion with China's Foreign Minister is locked in, it'll be the second meeting in less than 12 weeks after a 2-year diplomatic freeze. So another sign both countries are willing to try to normalise this relationship, but there's still been little progress since Labor came to office on some of the big disagreements between Australia and China, including trade disputes and the detention of Australian citizens. Penny Wong making it clear the government won't give ground on issues crucial to our national interest.
In terms of China, I've made clear that, you know, we are open to engagement. I understand those arrangements are being finalised, and if they are finalised, then I'm sure that we will have a productive engagement. What I would say to you is our position, whether in the meeting or outside of the meeting, remains consistent in relation to Australia's national interest.
Meanwhile, the Defence Minister says our national interests will be the deciding factor on whether to keep a fleet of army helicopters that have been plagued with operational problems. The French government has a stake in the manufacture of the Taipan choppers, and they are lobbying Australia not to ditch them like we ditched the French submarines. So this could be another flashpoint in the relationship with France. Richard Marles says no decision has been made yet, but Australia is communicating openly about where things are at.
We've been completely clear and upfront and honest with the French, and they know that too, and I think they appreciate that. We need to be making sure we have the best capability possible, but it needs to provide value for money, and so that's what's being looked at.
Davina, the French president is set to make a personal appeal during a scheduled visit to Australia in November.
Okay, Eliza, thank you. Curfews are being imposed and people are being urged to flee flood risk areas as Hurricane Fiona blasts the Turks and Caicos Islands in the Caribbean. A Category 3 storm has left a path of devastation through the Dominican Republic and Puerto Rico, where most people remain without electricity or running water. Three people have died so far. The storm hit on the anniversary of Hurricane Maria, which also caused devastation and killed 3,000 people. Iranian women have cut their hair and burnt their headscarves in a fifth night of protests over the death of a 22-year-old in custody after being detained by the country's morality police. She'd allegedly not worn a proper Islamic hijab. Protests have been intensifying over recent days, with some in the crowd chanting death to the dictator. At least five people have died in recent days as security forces try to regain control.